One of the amazing things that we've been able to see through the book of Isaiah is just God's incredible sovereignty. His sovereignty that can give us so much confidence and security that He's carrying out His plan of redemption. No matter what the nations say, no matter what goes on, no matter the rebellion that people exercise against Him, He still will carry out His plan. That no government, no army, not the demons from hell, not Satan, not anyone can thwart what God has planned. And He will bring it to pass. That's what we get from that. And in terms of practical application for us, it should give us confidence. Instead of, I know a lot of people or some Christians struggle with the sovereignty of God, somehow thinking that by us exercising our abilities, our will, that somehow we will have a better chance of achieving what it is that we want. But I'm so thankful. Be honest, this morning I can say this to you. I am so thankful that our God is sovereign, that He not only sovereignly called me to salvation, that He sovereignly carried that out through the finished work of the Lord Jesus Christ on the cross, but as He said in His Word, that He will sovereignly carry it out to its completion when I'm glorified, when we are glorified. And I'm so thankful that in spite of what I go through in this life, how hard life may be at times, and life may be tough, that I can trust the sovereignty of God to carry out His plan in my life. What He said in His Word in Romans chapter 8, verse 28, all things work for the good of those who love the Lord and are called according to what? His purpose. Not my will, not my plans, but according to His purpose. And then He gives us the reason why. For those whom He foreknew, He also predestined to be conformed to the image of His Son. And those whom He predestined, He also called. Those whom He called, He also justified. And those He justified, He also glorified. As far as God is concerned, our salvation is complete. And it is complete. Faithful is He, Paul writes to the church in Philippi, who called you and He'll bring it to pass. To Him who is able to keep you from falling, Jude tells us, God will complete that. And I am so thankful for that. I'm so thankful that when we, our family, face cancer and the eventual death of Kim, that we can trust the sovereignty of God in what He said in His Word. When the psalmist in Psalm 139 said, all the days ordained for me were written in your book before one of them came to be. And in Job 14, when he said, for you have ordained the number of months and the number of years, and no man can exceed what you have ordained. And so God is the one who is sovereignly carrying out His plan. He's the one who is fully in charge of our lives. I like that. I don't know about you, but I rest in that. But he's not a God who simply is exercising His power and His sovereignty and not caring about His people. In the book of Isaiah, in chapter 40, and we will get there eventually sometime, I love the combination of that, because you see the sovereignty of God in that, and yet in the midst of that, in verse 11 of chapter 40, he says, God tends His flock like a shepherd. He gathers the lambs in His arms and He carries them close to His heart. That's our God. One thing that we will see here this morning is the beautiful and surprising grace that this sovereign God shows us. He showed it at the beginning of time in Genesis 3:15 when man first rebelled, when He promised the seed of the woman. And He showed it to the lineage of Adam in Genesis 5 when you could see the death bell ringing all the time, and he died, and then you find Enoch. He walked with God and then he was no more. He didn't die. You find it from Genesis 6 through 9 about when God renders a judgment that every intent in the heart of man was nothing but wicked and evil all the time, meaning that every man, every single woman, every single child was guilty of rebellion against God, and there was not an ounce, there was not a moment of righteousness in man, and man was deserving God's judgment, and yet it says there, but Noah found grace in the eyes of the Lord. You find it in Genesis chapter 12, where out of the area of Babylon, of Chaldea, where false religion was born, God calls a man named Abram. And he said, I will show you, I will take you to a land that I will show you. I want you to go to a land that I will show you. And then he made that promise in verses 1 through 3 that through him, through his seed, all the nations of the world would be blessed. And you see that all throughout the scriptures. Some people will say, in the Old Testament, you find a God who is angry, who is vengeful. And in the New Testament, you find that it's a God who is gracious. But yet, actually, you see when you read the scriptures, when you step back from all of scriptures, from Genesis all the way to Revelation, what you see is the grace of God. And that's something that I want us to see this morning, that I think you'll be surprised at what we see here. But first, he's speaking about the judgments here against nations in chapter 19 and 20, but we'll just look at 19. He's speaking about the judgment against Egypt. Primarily, remember the background of this, Assyria was still on the prowl, except they've taken Assyria had taken off its eyes off of the part Palestine and the southern part of that, and so they were trying to rebel. Syria and the northern kingdom Israel were trying to rebel, trying to form an alliance against to rebel against Assyria, and so what they wanted Judah to be a part of that. Judah, however, King Ahaz had already made a treaty with or an alliance with Assyria, trying to buy their influence. And there were some people in the king's court who wanted them to go down to Egypt to find refuge in Egypt. And so God pronounces through the prophet this judgment against Egypt, basically reminding his people what he had said. And it's only by trusting him that they will have their salvation, that they can find salvation. And so here God was going to judge the prophecy of the judgment of Egypt, beginning in verse 1 all the way through 15. But first, it talks about Egypt's internal troubles in verses 1 through 4. It says an oracle, again, some of your translations would say a burden, because it's something that is heavy. An oracle concerning Egypt. It says, see, the Lord rides in a swift cloud and is coming to Egypt. This is an imagery, by the way, in Canaanite religion, where they believed that Baal was the god of rain and fertility. Well, he was the god of all kinds of things. But that he was also, according to Canaanite beliefs, that he would ride the clouds swiftly. And the prophet was saying here, see, the Lord Yahweh rides in a swift cloud and is coming to Egypt. In Psalm 68, verse 4, this is what it says, sing to God, sing in praise of his name. Extol him who rides on the clouds. Rejoice before him. His name is Yahweh. His name is the Lord. So he's the one. Everyone else, including Baal, was a pretender. The idols of Egypt tremble before him, and the hearts of the Egyptians melt within them. This is a personalizing of the idols. Of course, the idols have eyes, but they could not see because they were simply man-made idols. And yet God portrays the idols of Egypt as afraid of him. And so that the people who would go to the idols, their idols, were also afraid. Verse 2 says, I will stir up Egyptian against Egyptian. Brother will fight against brother. Neighbor against neighbor. City against city. Kingdom against kingdom. There will be an internal strife that's going to happen, that's going to demolish the security and the sense of peace that the nation had. Verse 3, the Egyptians will lose heart, and I will bring their plans to nothing. They will consult the idols and the spirits of the dead, the mediums and the spiritists. They were still resorting to their religion. They were still going to their idols looking for answers. But God says, I will frustrate their plans. And in verse 4, he says, I will hand the Egyptians over to the power of a cruel master, and a fierce king will rule over them, declares Yahweh, declares the Lord of hosts, the Lord Almighty. Of course, he's talking here, historically, this has already happened, this verse 4, when he said, I will hand the Egyptians over to the power of a cruel master. Now, when you read, if you were living in those times and you read the paper and you knew what was going on, that the Assyrian kingdom was an evil, very cruel and vicious Assyrian king named Esarhaddon. And in 671 BC, he conquered Egypt and put Egypt to flight and really destroyed them. And it actually destroyed the kingdom and their ability to be able to function. literally for millennia. And so he says, I will hand the Egyptians over to the power of a cruel master, and a fierce king will rule over them, declares the Lord Almighty. And then he describes, beginning in verse 5 through 10, what is going to happen to their economy, what God was going to do because of his judgment against Egypt. The one thing that the Egyptians had, that they always was the source of their prosperity. Remember in the book of Genesis, when the whole world, that part of the world, was going through drought and famine. They had food in Egypt. Why? Because they had the Nile. Now, listen to what God had to say to them. Verse 5. The waters of the river here refers to the Nile. The river, the waters of the river will dry out, and the riverbed will be parched and dry. The canals will stink, the streams of Egypt will dwindle and dry up. The reeds and the rushes will wither, also the plants along the Nile, at the mouth of the river. Every sown field along the Nile will become parched, will blow away and be no more. The fishermen will groan and lament, all who cast hooks into the Nile. Those who throw nets to the water will pine away. Those who work with combed flax will despair. The weavers of the linen will lose hope. The workers of cloth will be dejected, and all the wage earners will be sick at heart. The whole economy will basically collapse because of the drying up of the Nile. There will nothing, everything else that is based on that, from agriculture to fabric making, to everything else, to flax, which they use for roof and other things, everything will collapse and there will be no more. And then not only that, look at verses 11 through 15. One of the things that you will find about Egypt was considered in the ancient world as one of the pillars of wisdom, of knowledge. The library in Alexandria, and actually the city of Alexandria itself, rivaled only Athens in those days as the seat of knowledge and wisdom. It was known for its wise men and for its wisdom. But look at what God is saying here, beginning in verse 11. It says, the officials of Zoan are nothing but fools. He mentions here two cities, two major cities. Both of them were one time the capital of Egypt. One was Zoan, the other one is Memphis in verse 13. But it says, the officials of Zoan are nothing but fools. The wise counselors of Pharaoh give senseless advice. How can you say to Pharaoh, I'm one of the wise men and a disciple of the ancient kings? Where are your wise men now? Let them show you and make known what the Lord Almighty has planned against Egypt. If they're going to be smart and wise, what is God going to do for them? Let them be known. Tell Pharaoh about it. The officials of Zoan, verse 13, have become fools. The leaders of Memphis are deceived. The cornerstones of our peoples have led Egypt astray. It's interesting, the language that he uses here, because he uses the word, this architectural word, cornerstone, when he spoke to Judah about Christ being the cornerstone. And yet, here's a nation, here's an empire, a kingdom, whose cornerstone was their wisdom and their wise men. And he's saying the cornerstones of our peoples, the thing that they thought they could base their lives on was wisdom and their wise men, and yet they have led Egypt astray. The Lord has poured unto them a spirit of dizziness. They make Egypt stagger in all that she does. As a drunkard staggers around in his vomit, there is nothing Egypt can do. Head or tail, palm branch or reed. Head and palm branch refer to the leaders, and the tail and the reed refer to the people. And saying, it doesn't matter where you go. You go up to the king's palace, there's nothing but foolishness. You go to the people, and there's nothing but foolishness. Because no one knows the Lord. No one could know what God had said. The very foundation of their society, their economy, their politics, civil order, and not even their wisdom. God was judging them. When I was reading this and I was studying this, I think a lot about how we depend so much on our own wisdom. The Apostle Paul said the same thing in 1 Corinthians chapter 1. When he said to the church in Corinth, who were so much into this Greek philosophy, he said, the Jews look for signs and wonders. Greeks look for wisdom. He said, but we preach Christ crucified, Colossians chapter 2, he tells us that in Christ, all of wisdom and understanding, all of wisdom and knowledge can be found in Christ. Over the years, I've had people who tell me that it doesn't make sense or something doesn't make sense, so it cannot be. That's how liberalism had tried to rob us of the testimony, the assurance that we have in the Word of God, because it doesn't make sense. To them, it cannot be truth. It cannot be wisdom. And I've said this to you before. The wisdom of man, the mind of man, our ability, if we can fully exercise this wisdom, it's kind of like a six-inch ruler trying to measure the vastness of the universe. And you say, and the six-inch ruler says, there cannot be a universe. There cannot be an Atlantic Ocean, a Pacific Ocean, because it's within the 6 inches, it cannot comprehend that. I say, I'm quoting again, it says, who has understood the mind of the Lord? Who had taught him his ways? Who had been his counselor? Well, the answer is nobody. Why? Because he is the all-wise, knowledgeable God. And you don't have to turn, but just listen to this. This is what God says about rulers. When rulers rule, when God sends his the Messiah, this is how he's going to rule, in contrast to what we have today. We've looked at this, but in chapter 11 of the book of Isaiah, it says, a shoot will come up from the stump of Jesse, and from his roots a branch will bear fruit. And then beginning verse 6, it says, the Spirit of the Lord will rest on him, the Spirit of wisdom and of understanding, the Spirit of counsel and power. Remember in chapter 9, when he was described as wonderful counselor, when Christ is described as the wonderful counselor, when I do counseling, well, let me back up. When I still live in Border, people will tell me, so you're a good friend of Ken Shepherd. He was a preacher who did Tim's funeral. And I'll say, yes. And he said, man, he's such a wise man. And I told Ken that, because so many people will tell me that, he's such a wise man. He said, you know, I don't know where, but I can see that. He said, it's not me. Is I normally listen to them when I'm doing counseling, and as I'm listening, I'm praying, and I will take them to the scriptures, and then I will show them from the scriptures how they can change, how they can align their lives according to the Word of God. And that's really what wisdom is. He says, the Spirit of wisdom and of understanding, the Spirit of counsel and of power, the Spirit of knowledge and of the fear of the Lord, and he will delight in the fear of the Lord. That's the Messiah. That is how he's going to rule his people. That's how he's going to rule the world when he establishes his millennial kingdom. But here you find the advisors, the wise men of Egypt, reduced to nothing. Again, look at verse 11 again. They're described as fools. They give senseless advice. Verse 13, they have become fools. They themselves are deceived. And in verse 13, they who were the cornerstones of their people have led Egypt astray. And verse 14, the Lord has poured into them a spirit of dizziness. They were like drunk men. You wouldn't ask a drunk man for counsel, for advice, even for directions. And yet it says this is what's going to happen to them. And then in summary, in verses 16 and 17, this is also not just a summary of what he just said, 1 through 15, but it's also a bridge between what he had said, the judgment that he was going to render to the nation of Egypt, but also to how he's going to deal with Egypt in the future. In that day, that's a phrase that Isaiah uses 45 times in his prophecy. It's about a quarter of times that it's used in all of the Old Testament, and Isaiah uses it talking about eschatologically, meaning in the future, about what is going to happen. In that day, it says the Egyptians will be like women. Notice the descriptions of what's going to happen. They will shudder with fear at the uplifted hand that the Lord Almighty raises against them, and the land of Judah will bring terror to the Egyptians. Now, you might say, in this instance, how could Judah bring terror to them? Well, the psalmist tells us that they were afraid The Egyptians were afraid. The nations were afraid. The Song of Moses tells us that the nations were afraid because of what they had seen God do to Egypt and in Egypt. When he freed his people, when he carried them on eagle's wings and he freed them from bondage. That is what is, so people were afraid. And on Monday nights and Monday afternoons, we'll be going through the book of Joshua. And one of the things we saw in chapter 2 was Rahab, who was in Jericho. And when she was talking to the two spies who were spying out the land, and she says, our hearts melt with fear because we heard what your God has done to the kings and also in Egypt. So there was this fear that's going to strike at the heart of Egypt. Judah will bring terror to the Egyptians. Everyone to whom Judah is mentioned will be terrified because of what the Lord Almighty is planning against them. So there will be this fear. There will be this terror. There will be this horror to the nation of Egypt. But don't despair or don't celebrate too much. I know when we read the papers today and we see what Muslims are doing in the world, and I've heard people say this, you know, by golly, we just need to go in and stand up for it. We do need to do that. We need to draw the line. We need to engage them in a military way, in a diplomatic way, so that they can protect our interests and protect the people there for humanitarian reasons. But we've got to view the world events according to the Word of God and there find confidence and there find comfort. Because look at what it says, beginning in verse 18. Because what God is about to do is a very nation, a very people that he was judging. He's about to show grace to them. And really, when you look at 16 and 17, you will find 16 and 17, the terror, the horror, the fear that had befallen the nation of Egypt was simply a prelude to their repentance and what God was about to do for them. Look at verse 18 through 25. It says, in that day, five cities in Egypt will speak the language of Canaan. It's interesting, he said, five cities in Egypt. This harkens back. Remember, this was not a prophecy. Isaiah was not speaking to the Egyptians. Who was he speaking to? Come on, guys. Who? Israelites, Judah. Specifically, the southern kingdom. He's speaking to the whole nation as a whole. It's primarily speaking to Judah. So he's speaking to the Israelites. So what was he saying? He says, in that day, five cities in Egypt will speak the language of Canaan. It's interesting, he says, five cities. Why is that important? Well, to them, to the Jewish people, it harkens back to the language of Exodus. It harkens back to the language of Joshua when they conquered the land. When God freed them from Egypt, and they went into the land under the leadership of Joshua. And there were five cities that were specifically mentioned in Joshua chapter 10. That they conquered Jerusalem, Hebron, Yarmuth, Lachish, and Eglon. Five cities, and to them, five cities in Egypt will speak the language of Canaan. What does that mean? That means they will speak Hebrew. Why? Why is that important? Well, look at the text. And swear allegiance to whom? What does your Bible say? To the Lord of hosts, to the Lord Almighty. Notice the word Lord. It's all caps. It's speaking about the covenant-making name of God. They will recognize Yahweh himself. So he says, in that day, five cities in Egypt, just as he's freed his people, so will he free the Egyptians. He said, they will speak the language of Canaan and swear allegiance to Yahweh, the Lord of hosts. One of them will be called the City of Destruction. The City of Destruction, the way it's written, some of your translations will say City of Destruction. Some of your translations will say it's the City of the Sun. There is a city today, modern city, called Heliopolis. Helios is the word for sun. Polis means city. And it sits just 2 miles outside of the ancient city of Heliopolis. And God is saying here in verse 18, five cities in Egypt will speak the language of Canaan, meaning that they will
pledge allegiance and swear to the Lord Almighty, one of them will be called the city of destruction. One of those cities will be Heliopolis, which is still in existence today. In that day, verse 19, there will be an altar to the Lord, to Yahweh, in the heart of Egypt. There will be an altar that was dedicated to Yahweh, meaning that they will offer sacrifices, meaning that he will be recognized. In Genesis chapter 12, when Abram went to the promised land and God led him there, he went up north and then went west and then came back down south. One of the first things that he did was he built an altar. And remember when we were going through the book of Genesis, Canaan was filled with altars to all these gods, and probably when he was building the altar, people probably were asking him, why are you building this altar? You can just come to our church. We already have this church. We've got this building. We've got these gods that we worship. And you remember what it says, and he called on the name of the Lord. I know most of the times we will translate the word called as meaning that he prayed, and he probably did that, but it was also the same word that is translated in Exodus when God wanted to show himself to Moses. When Moses wanted to see the glory of God, God put him in the cleft of the rock, and as he passed by Moses, he saw part of who God was, and the Lord says, proclaiming, same word that's translated called in Genesis chapter 12. So Abraham was not simply just praying to God, but he was proclaiming to these people who worshiped these other gods who God was, who Yahweh was. And in that day, that was going to happen also in Egypt. That there will be an altar. So it's not just an altar, kind of like, okay, they'll just be worshiping this quiet community. No, it's going to be a testimony as to who the only true God is. Not only there will be an altar to the Lord in the heart of Egypt, and it also says in verse 19, and a monument to the Lord at its border. Some of your translations has the word pillar for monument. The idea of a pillar or monument at the border was the idea that sets forth the parameters of the kingdom of the king. And normally in those ancient days, they would set up monuments that had the image of the king or the emperor in those places. You knew you were going into this place. You knew you were entering his kingdom. God had prohibited his people, Deuteronomy chapter 7, about the pillars that they would encounter, the pillars of the Asherah poles and all of that, that the pagans worship in Canaan. But here, I believe the meaning of this is different than that, because it's talking about monuments and pillars to the Lord. It probably harkens more back to what Joshua did when he went into the promised land, when they crossed the Jordan on dry ground, and they set up pillars in the middle, and then they set up pillars also on land, and they set up pillars everywhere as monuments to who their God was, as a reminder, as a memorial, so that they will not forget who God was. So in that day, the only true God will be known in Egypt. I don't know about you. I get blown away when I read this section here. Because most of us have grown up in church. I mean, we say it in youth camps, Pharaoh, whoa, let my people go. And we think of them, even the way we look at current events today, Egypt, Assyria, the area there in the north, even Syria. We think of those places as enemies of the United States, and they are in a lot of ways. But what is amazing to me, it's always amazing to me in the scriptures, is God's grace. Totally undeserved, totally a gift, always surprising, because you never expect it. Verse 20, it will be, says, a sign and a witness to the Lord Almighty in the land of Egypt. So you see these signs. You walk in there, you go into the land, and you will sign. No longer will be the relief or the statues of pharaohs dominating the land. It'll now be the altar in the heart of Egypt and the monuments and the pillars that proclaim that Yahweh is God, that Yahweh is the God of the Egyptians. And then that part of verse 20 says, when they cry out to the Lord because of their oppressors. I don't know about you, to a Jew, and even just reading this, on Mondays, we've been studying for the man, we've been going through this, the books of Moses, and the Old Testament really for a long time, for probably over 2 years, 2.5, maybe 3 years. We just want to cover that, because really understanding the books of Moses allows you to understand the rest of the Old Testament. You cannot understand the Old Testament, the rest of the Old Testament, unless you understand what the books of Moses, everything that the prophets, everything that happened and during the period of the judges, during the period of conquest before that, period of the judges, and then during the period of the kings and the prophets, all look back to what God had already said through the books of Moses. And so, but here, it says when they cry out to the Lord because of their oppressors. Now let me ask you this, those of you who have read the book of Judges, does this sound familiar to you? God is using a language that he used to describe the cry for help of his people. He's using it to refer to the Egyptians. And notice what he says, how he's going to respond to them. And notice it's not talking to an army. He's speaking in singular terms. He says, when they cry out to the Lord because of their oppressors, he will send them a savior and defender, and he will rescue them. I believe, because of the language that is used here, that the one who will save them, more than just from physical turmoil and trouble, but also give them spiritual life, is the Lord Jesus Christ. I believe he's speaking about the Messiah himself. And then in verse 21, So Yahweh will make himself known to the Egyptians. Now think back at Exodus. How did the Egyptians know God in Exodus? The Israelites knew him as the gracious God, as the one who made a promise to their fathers, to Abraham, to Isaac, and to Jacob. The Egyptians knew him as the powerful God protecting his people, but they knew him as the one who brought on the plagues to the nation. But here, look at what it says. The Lord will make himself known to the Egyptians, and in that day, they will acknowledge the Lord. So in the same way that God manifested himself to his people in Exodus, and in a very different way that he manifested himself to the Egyptians at the time of the Exodus, now he will make himself known to the Egyptians in the same way that he's made himself known to his people. I don't know about you, I know when I talk to some people about this stuff, when I read them, and I've read this in several venues, there are people who would actually come up to me and say, that's in the Bible? I say, yes. Actually, you find this in Genesis chapter 12, verse 3 says that through your seed, all the nations of the world, all the ethnos of the world, all the peoples of the world will be blessed. Sometimes it is our sense of self-righteousness that makes us think that we're the only ones deserving of salvation. That those dingbats, those Muslims, those terrorists, they don't deserve anything from God except the fires of hell. But when you look, step back from the scriptures and you read passages like this, and you read passages like 2 Peter, which says, it's not God is not slow in keeping his promises, some consider slowness to be, but he is patient, because it is not his will that anyone should perish, but that everyone should come to repentance. John 3:16, you know the text. Let's say it. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever will believe in him shall not perish but have everlasting life. That is open to everyone. And that's always been his heart. And so in that day, God will send the Savior and the Defender, and he will rescue them. The Lord will make himself known to the Egyptians, and in that day they will acknowledge the Lord. And then I love this. Really, before I came across this passage a while back, years ago, I used to think, and I would say this even when I would teach, I said only the Jews would offer sacrifices. We're not required to do that. We're not. But then it says, they, talking about the Egyptians, will worship with sacrifices and grain offerings. This is the language of Leviticus. And I think God was saying to them, to the Israelites, I will save Egypt. And not only will I save them, they will take part in what I have demanded from you in the way my holy people worships their holy God. Meaning that their sacrifices will not be any different. It will not be inferior to what they were doing. It will be the same, because it's the same God, it's the same call, it's the same grace that has been given them. And then, the latter part of verse 21, it says, they will make vows to the Lord and keep them. There's a part of me that wants to think, okay, God is kind of like hinting at them. Do you remember in Deuteronomy, in Exodus, in Deuteronomy, when Moses said, when he ratified the laws of Moses, the laws of God that he had given them, and he ratified it by sprinkling blood, animal blood on the people, and the people said, everything that God had commanded, what? We will do. Did they do it? No. But look at what it says. They will make vows to the Lord and keep them. They will be able to keep it, because they will be a part not of the Mosaic law, but of the new covenant, not the old covenant, which was external, written on tablets of stones, and they did not have the Holy Spirit to allow them to be able to give them the strength and the wherewithal to be able to follow it. But now in the new covenant, Ezekiel 35, Jeremiah 31, I will write my laws and my decrees in their hearts. It says, I will give them my spirit. I will remove their hearts of stones and give them hearts of flesh. I will write my laws and my decrees in their hearts. And God says, and I will cause them to obey my laws and my decrees. Faithful is he who has called us, and he will bring it to pass. And by the way, this tells us really in how we even live our lives. I know this is a struggle that we have, because we look at the Bible a lot of times, even as Christians today, and we think of it as a book of morals, simply to follow. But it's not just that. The dynamic of how we follow the Lord is that God lives in us now, as he had said in the new covenant that's been ratified, not by blood of animals, but by the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ, who died once and for all the righteous for the unrighteous, that you have been given everything you need for life. And God, in the second Peter says, that the fullness of God lives in us, Colossians chapter 2, verses 9 and 10, that in Christ all of deity lives in bodily form, and you have fullness in Christ. So Christ lives in us, the fullness of Christ lives in us, the fullness of God lives in us, the Holy Spirit has given us a new heart, he's written his laws in our hearts, and what we do in terms of living it out is not to kind of say, okay, I'll not do that, and I'll not watch that, I'll not be me anymore, but no, as we grow into the Word, as we understand, as our minds are changed, Romans chapter 2, chapter 12, verse 2, be transformed, be renewed by the renewal of your mind, that you may know God's will, his good, pleasing, and perfect will. Our minds are changed through the Word of God and Christ's righteousness. As we follow, as we understand who he is, he then lives out his righteousness in and through us. It's not an external desire that I say, today I will just love people, I will love my wife, I will love my children, I will love people. No, I cannot do that. Because Lakan himself has no ability, has no strength to do that. But we see in the scriptures that as we are filled with the Spirit, Ephesians 5:18, Colossians 3:16 explains that to us. Let the Word of Christ dwell in you richly, meaning the Word of God, as it dwells in us richly, changes our mind, changes our heart. And then Christ is manifested in that. And it is that, it is Christ in us, and then is able to follow his law, because that is his living out who he is. And he says that this is what's going to happen to the Egyptians. They will make a vow to the Lord and keep them. Look at verse 22. It says, the Lord will strike Egypt with a plague. There's a sense of a reminder for them. It says, the Lord will strike Egypt with a plague. This is the same God. This is not a different God. This is the same God that your forefathers experienced when he sent the plague. He says, he will send a plague. He will strike them with a plague. He will strike them, and then what? Look at the text. And he will heal them. They will turn to the Lord. And in contrast to what happened in the book of Exodus, where they had to plead with Moses, and Moses was the one who had to intercede for them, who would mediate to the Lord, the people of Egypt, so that God then would stop the plague. Now it says, they will call on me, and I will answer them. I will heal them.
And then verses 23 through 25 to the end of the chapter. It's probably one of the most amazing sections that you will find in the scriptures. Think about all of the history that we've been looking at for thousands of years. Assyria. Assyria was so mean, was so vicious, so cruel, that when God told, remember the story of Jonah? When God told Jonah, I want you to go to Nineveh, which is the capital of Assyria, and I want you to tell them, proclaim who I am. And Jonah knew that God was gracious and God was merciful. He said, I don't want to go. I know what you're going to do. You're going to save them. So he fled from God. Look at verse 23. This cruel, what's going to happen to this cruel, vicious, mean group of people? And of course, Egypt, we know what they did to the people of Israel. It says, in that day there will be a highway from Egypt to Assyria. Highway refers to commerce, communication, diplomatic relations, all of the things that are between two partnering nations. And if you remember, they were at war with each other. They were actually forming alliances. And I just said that in 571 AD, Esarhaddon, the king of Assyria, came down to Egypt and pretty much for at least two millennia destroyed Egypt. And yet, in that day, it says there will be a highway from Egypt to Assyria. But it's not just a highway of commerce, communication, diplomacy, and trade. Because it says Assyrians will go to Egypt and the Egyptians to Assyria. Why? The Egyptians and Assyrians will worship together. In that day, verse 24, Israel will be the third, along with Egypt and Assyria. Look at what it says. A blessing on the earth. You mean those turbaned, hairy, bearded, weird people? Yes. In that day, Israel will be the third, along with Egypt and Assyria, a blessing on the earth. And then look at verse 24, even the language of verse 25. The Lord Almighty will bless them. By the way, that language harkens back to the language of Deuteronomy 28. That if you obey the laws of my decrees, I will bless you. These are the things I'm going to do to you. And he says, the Lord Almighty will bless them, saying, don't miss the language that is used there. He says, blessed be Egypt, what? Someone tell me. My people. This was the nation to whom God sent Moses in Exodus. He says, let my people go, talking about the Israelites. They got so tired of that. But now in the end, in the future, God says, I will call Egypt my people. Assyria, my handiwork, the work of my hands. And Israel, my inheritance. We were talking about that in Sunday school today, because in Ephesians chapter 1, Paul prays a wonderful prayer. He said, I pray that the eyes of your heart may be enlightened, that you may know the hope that you have in Christ. And then the second thing that he mentions, his glorious inheritance in the saints, meaning that the inheritance that Christ is going to have at the end of the ages is us, those of us who know Christ. I don't know about y'all. I'm just blown away by the grace of God. And the only way that we will not be touched by this is if we think that you and me deserve some kind of, deserve our, in some way, our salvation. But God clearly tells us that we're all sinners, just like the Egyptians, just like the Assyrians. You and I belong in the same category. Maybe you've not been guilty of cruelty and viciousness as the Assyrians were guilty of. Or maybe it's the sin hints that Paul described in Colossians. But nonetheless, we're all guilty. And that's why Paul could write in Ephesians chapter 2, for it is by grace you have been saved. It is not of yourselves, it is a gift from God. It is a gift from God. You don't pay for a gift, do you? simply give it to you. It is not work for you to simply receive a gift. That is not work. I know some of our friends would tell us, evangelicals would say, well, by trusting Christ, you're working at it. No, you're not working at it. A man who simply receives food, a beggar who simply receives food is going to give it to him. He does not work for it. He does not merit it. He does not deserve it. But he simply receives it. That is what faith does. That is our appropriation of what God has freely given us. When I think about this, I think about sometimes loved ones that we have, we pray for them. Loved ones who do not know the Lord Jesus Christ. Sometimes we get so aggravated because you're going, man, can they not receive this? But instead of looking at them, I want to encourage you this morning. Instead of looking at what they're doing and how they're reacting, look at God, His nature, His character, His heart, His grace. And that He's the one more than you and me, more than all of us. He's the one who's more interested in our loved one's salvation. So what do? We pray, and we keep praying, and we keep trusting Him, standing on who He is, standing on what He's already said in His word. I do that when I pray for my loved ones. Lord, You said You love the whole world. You said that it's not Your will that anyone should perish. So I know and I stand in Your word that You don't want so-and-so to perish. And so I'm praying that You will touch his heart, that he will see You for who You are and cry out to You as his Savior, as his God. And that's what we do, we pray. Second thing is, I want us, when we look at the world today, the world events, don't lose heart. And that is why over the years, I know I've said this, some of you probably have wondered, don't be just so quick to, yes, we have to side with Israel, yes, because they are God's people and the Word of God tells us to do that. But don't be so quick to dismiss the non-Israelites. Understand what the will of God is also for them. Understand the heart of God. Have the same compassion that the Lord has for them, that He would also bring them back, or bring them to His fold. Understand it through the lens of His heart and His word, that we might also see those people for who God, the way God sees them. And then thirdly, in our life today, we live our lives. I know we get so busy, we get so preoccupied with doing things, making our own plans, and I'm not saying don't make any plans. But it's so comforting for me, not just to trust God's sovereignty, but also to trust His grace, that He's a gracious God. He already said that to us. Not only did He give us grace and salvation in 2 Corinthians chapter 12, when Paul asked for help, that God would remove, that Christ would remove the thorn in his flesh. You remember when Christ, how the Lord Jesus Christ responded to him. He said, the issue is really not about the thorn in your flesh. And we might paraphrase that today for us, that the issue is really not the circumstances you find yourself in. The issue is not the rebellion of your son or your daughter. The issue is not the divorce that you're facing. The issue is not the lack of money that you have. The issue is not the cancer or the heart problems that you have or whatever issues that you have. The answer is that my grace is sufficient for you at all times. Can we trust God? Yes. Do we trust Him? Will we trust Him? Will you trust Him? That trust in His sovereignty, that He carried out through what Christ did on the cross, and learning to trust Him in His grace begins at the point of salvation. I say this again. Something I pray for our church. I pray for our church is here in San Angelo because I see it all the time. And I'll say it again. The reason some of us struggle with trusting Him in our daily life is because we would look back to something that we did. I asked Jesus into my heart. I walked down the aisle. I said a sinner's prayer. I was baptized, but there was no fruit in our life because there was no true conversion that happened. You cannot have the fullness of God in you and not produce some fruit in your life. Amen. It's not in the Bible. And so please, examine yourself as the Lord tells us, and find out where you really stand with Him. If you have no desire for him, if you have no horror about your sins, if there's no fruit whatsoever, the fruit of the Spirit, then he says in Galatians 5, and in fact in Galatians 5 he says the fruit of the flesh is obvious. Are those the things that characterize you, the fruit of the flesh? He says the fruit of the Spirit is. Are those things characterize you? John 15, Jesus said, by our fruits, if we bear much fruit, this will prove to them that we are his followers. Also in the Gospel of John, he tells us, by this all men will know that you are my disciples if you love one another. How are we doing? But it begins in true conversion. What is true conversion? Recognizing the holiness of God. And as we see his holiness and his majesty and his beauty, we recognize that our sin is more than lying, it's more than whatever it is we've done. But our life is full of that. And that what we have offended is not society, not another person. But as the psalmist, Psalm 51 says, only against you, Lord, have I sinned. That we offended him. And that you and I cannot do anything about that. For the wages of sin is death. And then we see the glory of God's provision in his Son, in the finished work of the Lord Jesus Christ on the cross. And to him we cry out for salvation, Lord, save me. Lord Jesus, save me. And the Bible says that anyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. True conversion. That's what happens. And then we can live and trust the grace of God every single day, no matter how you feel. No matter what your circumstances may be, let's pray. Father, it's just amazing to see your patience, to see your grace. Totally undeserved, totally a gift. Unearned, unmerited. Not just for the Egyptians and Assyrians, but for us. Father, may we live our life in the light of your grace. May we live our life based on your grace. So that no matter what happens, no matter what we're going through, Father, we will experience your grace that is sufficient. Not only at salvation, as we look back to that, but every single day. So that the world would know who you are. As they see you manifesting your grace in our life, in sickness and in health, in poverty and in riches, in life and in death. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Would you stand?